some things I'm interested in, obviously programming languages. I do mobile. Extreme web is something that is stuff that I call like WebRTC and WebGL, that kind of thing. Data, that's actually really what has me into Python is data. I like to come to conferences and talk to people, and I'm appreciative when they listen. Actually, it's kind of interesting. 2 weeks ago, I was in Knoxville, where, of course, University of Tennessee is for CodeStock. So 2 weeks ago, everything I saw was volunteers, and this weekend, everything I'm seeing is Buckeyes. So I'm also involved in the Python community. I'm co-director of the Memphis Python user group with my colleague Brad Montgomery next door. And then also, you may have seen Jason Myers running around here this weekend. He chaired the first ever Python conference for the state of Tennessee in Nashville back in February, and I was on the staff of that. So, and of course these will be available. In fact, you can go to my GitHub actually right now and get them if you want to follow along, or I'll put these up also in the amended version at the end. But if you just go to my GitHub at github.com/DouglasStarnes, you'll see the Py Ohio 14 repository, and then you can get to the NB viewer from there. This is how you can find me online and other places. I'll put this back up at the end also. The reason I went ahead and put my Twitter up there so that when I say something stupid during the presentation, you can flame me in real time. But basically what this is going to be introduction to natural language processing techniques using Python. And I'm going to do, most of what I'm going to do here is going to be using NLTK, the Natural Language ToolKit, which is a very popular and powerful framework for doing natural language processing within Python. Then towards the end, there are a few things that NLTK, it takes a lot of work to do, or some other techniques that you might want to use. So we're going to use some things. We're going to look at a library within scikit-learn. There's an alternate API. It's actually built on top of NLTK called TextBlob. And then if we have time, we might look at cleaning some stuff up with Beautiful Soup. So as I already said, NLTK is the Natural Language Toolkit. Software, data, and documentation. The documentation for this is excellent. It's open source libraries sometimes have a notorious reputation for not being very well documented. NLTK's documentation is wonderful. And also the authors have written a book which is free in HTML format online, which is also excellent. Most of what I've learned about NLTK has come from that book. Data. There are many corpora. These are the bodies of text that you'll analyze. And so sometimes, especially if you're just starting out, gathering those are sometimes a problem. So Natural Language Toolkit comes with some of those already. Let's see here. So. Definition of natural language, it's, a language that's spoken or written, used by humans for communication. We're using natural language right now. NLTK has facilities for many different languages. So I know that there's a corpus in Indian. I believe there's one in Sweden, and then there Swedish, and then there's some other ones. Well, I'll show you like some links to some Chinese ones at the end. But we're going to be using English today, mainly because that's the only language that I know very well. But I'll show off as we go along a few of the features that are used for other languages. And natural language processing, the automated analysis of natural language. Normally it's done by a computer, which is what we'll be doing today, obviously. So where would you use natural language processing? It's kind of interesting because we actually had a conversation about this in the car on the ride over. So, I imagine most people in here have taken some kind of an entrance exam. You had to write an essay for it. Many times, especially today, I know the GRE and GMAT do this now, that essay, you write the essay. I mean, it's a computer-based exam, so you type your essay on the computer during the exam. And sometimes, I believe for the GRE at least, you'll get your scores back immediately. Well, obviously they didn't ship that off to a person and they sent it back. I mean, a computer graded that, and that's actually beneficial because I remember back in, you know, back years ago when I was in grade school, they we would write these things out by hand, and they taught us very specifically how we had to structure, how we had to structure the essay and everything. A couple years later, I learned that the reason that they did this was because the people who were reading them only read it, only took about 60 seconds for each one. Now, granted, it wasn't very long, but they only took about 60 seconds for each one. So it was actually the way that they taught us how to, the way that they taught us how to do the essays was not for our benefit. It was more for the benefit of the person reading it to make it more efficient. Again, a computer, you don't have that problem. Computers also are going to be more objective. So sometimes we would be asked in these essays, you know, to take a position, and maybe you wrote a position that the person who was reading it didn't like. You know, if it's a subjective topic, you know, that can happen, and you can make it, and they could mark it down for that. Computer, probably not going to happen. Information retrieval is another way. This the obvious one here is, you know, you use this every day when you go to Google. And then there's some other, you know, such as text mining and things like that. Question answering. So this is more of a you know, more of a natural language search engine. What is the one out there that used to be around? Ask Jeeves, I believe, was one of those. And then also you could go into question generation. So you could feed the body of text and ask somebody, hey, you know, how much, you know, and generate questions to find out how much they retain, how much they really learned. Sentiment analysis. This is basically finding out how an author, if an author writes something on a particular topic, how do they feel about that particular topic? We're going to take an example, or take a look at a short example of sentiment analysis. Spam detection, obviously, you know, go through, feed the system examples of spam, tell it, hey, this is spam, this isn't, and then start feeding it just emails, and it'll, based on what it's learned, it'll say whether or not it's spam or not. I've got a sample. Actually, it's from a book that we'll look at if we have time for that. And it doesn't always have to be with data that's already in a computer. So optical character recognition. If you've got text, you know, from like an old book or something before computers, scan, you know, definitely can be work with that. Speech recognition. I used to work for a lab in a university where we're talking about natural language processing, and one of the things that they always thought would be interesting would be to, like, during a speech, to analyze the speech in real time and be able to show sort of like a sentiment analysis, or you know, how close were they on topic to the to what they were speaking about. And I mean, it's kind of happening today with Twitter. They're kind of doing that today, but it's from the listener's perspective, not the speaker's perspective. So that's a little bit the introduction. NLTK, and this is something I was having a discussion with one of the gentlemen in the audience here just before. So right now, NLTK is in version 3 for beta. Beta one was released just a few weeks ago, I believe. Now, today I'm going to be using NLTK 2, which only works with Python 2. NLTK 3 will work with Python, obviously, like you see here, 2.6 up or 3.2 up. The reason I'm using NLTK 2 today is because I have a practice of, when I start writing the presentation, whatever I'm using at that moment, I don't change it, because if something breaks in the middle, like I've had happen to me, then it's not a good situation. So I had already started this using NLTK 2, so that's what we're going to be using today. But at any rate, it's installation is a breeze. You just use pip, or you can download the package. You can get the latest version. I believe it's on GitHub, and install it just from the command line or using the Python interpreter. I was going to say something else. I believe it does have some C dependencies, so you probably have to run it as administrator. It also has soft dependencies on NumPy and Matplotlib. You can't, but some of the more advanced analysis techniques require those, and also even some of the more basic ones. You probably get some performance. You probably get some performance benefits because NumPy and Matplotlib are in C. And obviously, you'll want to have some data or corpora to experiment with. And the way that you do, and this is actually a separate download from the library, because these are huge and there's a lot of them. So there are several ways that you can do this. This one right here, what it'll do is it'll pop up a user interface dialog. And then you'll be able to, and you'll be able to select the ones that you want to use. There's also one that'll run in the command line in the shell as well. Let's see how I'm doing on time. Oh, okay, good. All right, so any questions yet? Wow. Okay, cool. So let's talk about some of the corpora that come with NLTK. So there are at least 40 of them. There's probably a whole lot more. You can create your own. You can download them off of the internet. But I want to show you some of the more popular ones here. And I don't think I'm going to have to type a lot, but I may have to edit some noise out of the video if I'm putting this down up and down a lot. So these are a few of the more popular ones: Gutenberg, Brown, Stop Words, the Pin Tree Bank, and WordNet. Basically you import these as modules, as you can see right here in Gutenberg. So you'll import your NLTK library, then there's a corpus module, and the Gutenberg is a class, but at any rate. And then if it works, importing NLTK can take a little while sometimes. You'll see what we've got here is we've got an instance of a plain text corpus reader. And this is nothing more than a collection of text documents. There's not a lot of metadata associated with it. It'll parse it out into words and sentences, perhaps. But what's going to happen is Gutenberg, and if you're not familiar with the Gutenberg project, this is basically a whole bunch of public domain, like old books. So what is it? So there's some of the works of Shakespeare in there. I know John Milton's Paradise is in there. Moby Dick is in there. So things like that. And then there's about 12 or 15 of them included in the Gutenberg corpus with NLTK. And then there are also other ones that you can go online and download. We're going to do that in just a minute. I think it's Sherlock Holmes is the example that I'm using. But every corpus, there are some things that there's kind of a structure that it follows. So here's one of the first ones. There's generally a file IDs method, and because they're different, because there are a lot of documents in a corpus, and the file IDs will show you what's in there. Okay, that's not going to work. So here you can see, like I said before, we got some Jane Austen, the King James Bible. Alice in Wonderland, Shakespeare, and other things. So if we want to use one of these, or at least if we want to get the words, and the words, what it'll do is it'll split the words into tokens. So what you'll have back is a list of words, more or less here, using the words, pass in a file ID. We'll take the first 20. And you'll notice that it also pulls out the punctuation, pulls those into special tokens by itself. And there's a good reason for that we'll see later on. We could also, if you want to tokenize the text yourself, raw, the raw method. And you'll see here now we've got all of our white space and. And in some cases, if there's Unicode in there, it'll put the Unicode out there as well. But this is if you want to have as much control as possible. What do I have that in there for? So let's see here. Also, it will parse. It'll also tokenize into sentences. So no surprise here. This will be a list of lists. So it'll parse. It'll tokenize each sentence into a list of words, and then it'll pop that into another list, so you have a list of lists, and that is the plain text corpus. Stop words. This one is very, very useful, even though it's very, very small. So a stop word is a word that doesn't add a whole lot of semantic. It's not what some people would call a juicy word. So it doesn't have a lot of influence on the meaning of the sentence. And these are things like the, and, or, if, as, things like that. And What you normally want to do is filter these out. So NLTK includes a list. The English one is about 120 some odd words, but there's really no definitive list of these. This is kind of subjective. So you can go out on, you can go Google for, you can Google for English stop words list or whatever, and find varying different opinions. But so here, of course, import the stop words corpus. Then for the words method, we're going to tell it which language we want, and then we'll just print out the first 25 words. And you can see it's normalized; it's all lowercase. And you can see pretty much what we're going to get. This is also the first place that we're going to see where we see different languages in NLTK, how NLTK can handle different languages. So the file IDs in this case are the different languages that are supported. So I'm just going to go through, get each of those, get the words for each language, and print out the first couple. And see, I think there's about 12 or 15 languages that are supported here. So for example, like in Danish, we have some special characters, and again in Hungarian, and then we've even got down here Russian as using the Cyrillic alphabet. So NLTK is definitely multilingual. All right. Here's one that's quite popular, the pin tree bank. So the pin tree bank, not surprisingly, organizes. It basically breaks sentences down into trees. And this is the example from Wikipedia showing how they do this. So they, this one I don't really understand this one, but this one's so you've got a noun part and a verb part, and then you break it down. It's a binary tree, you just break it down in each step. And once you get down to the end here, each of the leaves is going to be a word in the sentence. And notice that there is a label associated with each of these. This is the part of speech. So for example, street is a noun. Of and at are prepositions, and so on. And I'm sorry. This one, okay. This tag set I'm not familiar with. We're actually going to look at the tag set here. Actually, I believe next that's actually used with the pin tree bank. Yes, so the tag list is actually right here. And of course, you'll have access to these links in the notebook online. So some of these are kind of, and these don't necessarily make sense all the time. For example, adjective is JJ. And then there will be a lot, so for just a singular noun, it's NN instead of N. And then for plural and proper and so on, you'll often see numbers in there, cardinal number, preposition, N doesn't make a lot of sense for that. But, definitely adverb, because so many of these things start with A. Right.
So nothing corresponds to your tree that has single character.
Right. Yeah, like I said, that wasn't using the pin tree bank tag. No, that was meant to show off trees, not parts of speech tagging. Yeah. So, and like I said, you'll have access to all of these. So, again, bring in the module for the tree bank corpus. And here, what we have, since the parts of speech are there, we have a tagged words method. And what that's going to return is us a list of tuples where we can go ahead and look at it. I'm trying to keep from banging this against stuff. Where the first element in the tuple is the token, and the second one is the part of speech. So you see we've got some numbers in here, again, cardinal decimal. Years is a plural noun. Old is an adjective, of a preposition. Notice also that it is parsing out the punctuation, and it doesn't really have a part of speech. The punctuation is whatever was parsed out. Similar to the Gutenberg corpus, you can pull out entire tagged sentences. There's about 3,900 of them, so I'm only going to get the first. But all that is, that's just It's the same thing as we saw before. It's just now delimited by sentences. And later on we're going to look at how to do our tag our own text. And for that, we'll come back to the pin tree bank as well as another one. So the last corpus I'm going to take a look at here is WordNet. And of course, pin tree bank obviously comes from University of Pennsylvania. WordNet, it's very possible you've heard of this. This comes out of Princeton University in New Jersey. This one is completely different than I think any other. I don't think there's another corpus like this in NLTK. There may not be another corpus like this at all, but I know that this is different, definitely unique. What this has is this contains what they call synsets. Sometimes it's called a synonym ring. So what we're going to do here is these are words that are very similar in meaning, or sometimes they're sometimes sound to a given word. So again, pull in the corpus up on the first line. Then we're going to get all of the synsets for good. I'm going to go ahead and run this so we can talk about. Okay, so you're going to see that, and there are several properties that that apply to a synset. I've got three of them here. The name, which is the name which is composed of three parts. It's composed of a word, which is somehow related to the word that we originally wanted. So in this case, we have three other nouns that three nouns each of them have a different meaning for good. So they're all nouns, and then just a number to make it, and then just a sequential number to make it unique. And then after that, we have the part of speech, and these are not the same tags. There's actually a much simplified set of tags for the WordNet corpus. And then an example, a definition, not an example, a definition. So, you know, we have good as in benefit, good as in moral excellence, or we have good as in, you know, an article of commerce, like dry goods or sporting goods. And then good can also be, good could be an adjective. Several different ones here. I'm not going to go through all of them. Here are the WordNet part of speech tags. So this one, these probably make a lot more sense. N is noun, V is verb, A is adjective, S adjective satellite. This one, the way that it's been described is think of a hub and spoke, and so you've got an adjective that is the hub, and then you've got the satellites are the spokes. So it's kind of like one that's in similar meaning. Maybe it's a more abstract meaning than an adjective, an R for adverb. We could filter these by part of speech, so we can get the ones that are only for nouns. Nothing surprising there. And then we could also go through and some of them, as they have a definition, some of them also have an example. So here we have the definition, and then any examples that it might have. So these are all the nouns which are good. So the first three, which are actually the word good as well, and then here we have the one that was commodity for articles of commerce, and there weren't any examples for that one. And also, what you could do is you could actually pull this text in and do more analysis on it. So we're not going to do that today, but the possibilities for this, they give you so much data that you can work with. Now each synset can have a set of lemmas. Now a lemma is basically, it's kind of like the root form of a word. You also may have heard of stemming that we'll look at in just a minute. And the difference between lemmas, lemmatization is what they call it, and stemming is that stemming is a very mechanical approach that we'll see later on, whereas lemmatization gets more into the actual semantic meaning of the words. It looks at the vocabulary, looks at the meaning of the words to determine what the root is. So here what I've got is I've got the first of those nouns. That we saw up above, and I believe that was the one. Let me see here, which one was that? That was the one for moral excellence or admirableness. And there's going to be a set of lemmas, and a lemma has a has a has a structure similar to that of a synset, but also in so it's going to have a name and some other things, but it'll also have a set of antonyms, perhaps. And then we can see that for this particular one, that was the one, what was it, the moral excellence. So good and goodness. This is also sometimes called the morphological or canonical form of the word. And the antonyms, obviously, evil and evilness. Like I said before, you can do your own custom corpora for domain-specific data. And I'll show you some stuff that you can do to get started with that later on. And I think this is probably going to be the last thing, this string processing section, and then we'll break. And if people want to go to the 1 o'clock session, or if some people want to come in from the 12 o'clock session, we'll have the opportunity to do so. So, string processing, we're going to look at tokenization and stemming. So, tokenization, basically, what we're doing is we're breaking the text into meaningful pieces called tokens. The best way to think about good analogy for this is a mathematical expression. So if you've got, 4 minus 2, you can break that up into the two operands, 4 and 2, and the operator minus. Each of those is going to be a token. Obviously, with natural language, we're going to look at sentences or words. You could do paragraphs. There's also a process we're not going to look at today called chunking, which is kind of the next step after tokenizing, which basically breaks out the phrases. So the significant phrases, the phrases with significant semantic meaning. But there's also facilities in there for NLTK. We're just not going to have time to get to it today. So there are several ways, and this is not a trivial process. There are actually some interesting things that you have to take into consideration. So this is the Gutenberg project I was telling you about earlier. If you want some raw text to start with, this is the place to do it. These are just a list of books, and these are the top 100. So you can see they're all pretty old in here. But the one that we're going to use here is this one, Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. So to pull this in, do nothing. It's just use URL lib, like you would before, because the file itself is merely, it's just merely, whoops, this one here, it's just merely plain text. No attempt to do anything fancy with it. So bringing this in here, and then our first attempt at tokenizing, we could just try a naive method of splitting it on space. And you see that we do get our tokens, but in some places we get a mess, and especially down here. So, and then also we'll have some odd stuff like this over here. So it's not pulling out the punctuation either. The white space and the punctuation are being included along with other tokens. So what we could do is we could tell NLTK to tokenize. There's this function sent tokenize. And if we pull and we throw all the text into it, it will use its default method, which is probably going to be on, which is going to be something like on a terminator, such as a period or a question mark, to get the sentences out. And then notice that the sentences, so it's found 6,900 of them, and notice that the sentences are not tokenized by words the way that they were in the Gutenberg and the tree bank corpus. Each sentence is actually a string instead of a list. So, but also notice that some of your that are white space is still included. So there's also a word tokenizer, and we're going to use this one a lot later on because this one gives us pretty much what we want. This one uses the pin tree bank to generate the token, or at least the tree bank tokenizer to generate the tokens. And notice that it pulls the punctuation out like we want. The white space is gone. There are some.
Won't.
Yeah, that's the one I'm looking for.
Where?
There it is. Yeah. Okay. I increased the font, and so now everything's in the wrong place. So this one right here. This is one way. The way that it does contractions and punctuation sometimes is strange, but we could just take a white space tokenizer also, and that'll give us, and that will give us, that will put, yeah, that'll put won't all in one, but also at the same time, it now does not parse out our punctuation. So we have a word punct tokenizer that does that, but then again, won't. Now what it does is it parses out all of the punctuation separately. But still, you know, so these are just some different tokenizing methods. We're just going to stick with the regular word tokenize, the stock one that uses the tree bank corpus, because it'll do what we need for when we get to that later on. Okay, then stimming, and this will be the last thing that we do, and then we'll take a break. So stimming, like I said, this is similar to limitization, but it's a more mechanical, more even you could say naive process. Basically what it is, the process of reducing inflected words to their root or stem. An inflected word would be, so you'd have a stem word such as running, stem word such as run. An inflected word would be running, runner, runs. And this can indicate something like tense or gender, number, and other things. So the first step that we might look at is just to take a whole bunch of different suffixes. So ing, lyed, eis, and if we have a word that ends with that suffix, we're just gonna chop the suffix off. So we've got four examples here. And you can see it works pretty well. Run, play. Those would obviously be the stems, until we come to one in which the stem was modified for the inflection, such as running. So obviously, again, this is definitely a non-trivial process. So again, we need something better. And NLTK gives us several classes that we can use to do this. The most common and popular is probably going to be something called the Porter stemmer. And I'm not going to go into detail how this works, but I just want to show you that, like I said, this is a non-trivial process. Make this a little bigger. So this is the Python implementation. This is a Python implementation of the Porter stemmer. Let me see here. I want to go down to main. And basically what this does is this is a series of filters. Okay, right here. Goes through a whole bunch of steps, and each step will sort of take the obvious. It'll go from the easiest to the hardest. So, for example, up here in the first step, we're going to get rid of ed or ing. Second step, I'm not going to go through all of these. Second step, it'll go through one of the modifications. So often when we add a suffix to a word that ends in y, we have to turn it into an I. And you can see it's just really looking for a whole bunch of endings, and it'll take an action based on that. And again, you know, and different endings have different rules, so it's not. Not necessarily an easy process, but at the same time, as you can see, it knows nothing about the meaning of the word. It's just looking at the structure of the word. So it's a very, it's a very mechanical process. But what we'll do here is in the stem module, there's a Porter stemmer. We can just give those same words, and you can see this time. It gets everything correct except it got running correct. It only left one in on there. There's a regular expression stemmer which can be useful in some cases, but it's more of a brute force type thing. But notice here, it's only going to work with the specified suffix. So while it picked up talking, it did not stem talks correctly. So we would have to create another instance to pick up talked. And also, just like before with running, it's not going to pick up, it's not going to pull it out into two. So the Porter stemmer is pretty much what you're going to want to use. There's also another one, what's it called? The Lancaster stemmer. And really there's not a whole lot of difference between the two from what I've seen. It's just Porter was probably first. And so it's the more popular one. Here's another place where NLTK will support multiple languages. And this is with something called a snowball stemmer. Oh, here, I'll move that up. With a snowball stemmer. And what we need to do is we need to create a new snowball stemmer and give it a language. I'm going to use Spanish. I'm going to try to remember back to my high school Spanish. And there's this process in Spanish called conjugation, in which based on the tense, it's sort of the way of inflecting verbs in Spanish. So you may be familiar with the Spanish verb hablar, which means to talk. And so these are the different forms that the word can have. So you may have heard someone say, so if I were to say yo hablo, that would mean I speak. And then where's this one over here? There's one for like you speak and we speak and they speak and things like that. And there's also different gender for there's masculine and feminine forms of Spanish verbs. So what I'm going to do over here is I'm going to go back in here and I'm going to go into the stemmer and give it both hablar, which is to speak, and hablo, which is I speak. And you're going to see that it does come off with the same stem. Now the reason it doesn't come off with hablar both times is because of the way that the Spanish language works. But this, I have verified it that this is the correct stem, habl, if that's even a word in Spanish. So we are right at 12:45. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and break. We'll go ahead and start up again at 1 o'clock. And then we'll take about 45 more minutes, and then we'll have some time for questions after that. Or if during the next 15 minutes, want to start a discussion, please feel free. But hope to see you back here at 1 o'clock.